The Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Man is made from soil, as pottery clay is made from soil. We come from dust, and to dust we shall return. And so, God is indeed the potter, and man the clay. We are all the work of God's hand.
This is newly mixed clay. We're just doing the final aging before it's going to be used. What makes clay special is this quality, which is plasticity. You know, that you can mold it and form it like this. This is really a very special property in nature, and this can only happen from aging. It's actually a process of eroding stones that takes millions of years in the ground to create this plasticity. So in a sense, only God can really make clay.
Three qualities are essential for good pottery clay: plasticity, or moldability; porosity, or the ability to allow water to evaporate from the clay; and the quality of vitrifying in heat, which is the characteristic of the clay to transform into a glassy substance. These are the same qualities essential in the heart of man, if we are to be molded by God to become the leader He desires us to be. Our hearts need to be moldable to obey God's will. Our hearts need to be porous to let sin evaporate through confession. And our hearts need to have the ability to transform into the likeness of Jesus Christ in the very depths of our characters, by the power of the Holy Spirit, and through the sufferings that we go through in life. Good quality clay is essential in making good pottery. Good quality heart is essential in making a leader with godly character.
The most important step in making pots is wedging, because this is where we prepare the clay just before making. And when we do this, what we're going to do is remove the air bubbles and thoroughly mix the water into the clay. So it's a process of kneading and wedging. Wedging is where we cut the clay and throw it down on the table to pop and remove the air bubbles. This will probably be the most physical part of the whole process. The problem with air bubbles is air bubbles and inconsistencies in the clay will make it very difficult for me to center the clay on the wheel, which will make it very difficult to make the shape I intend to make. The other thing about air bubbles is that when they finally go in the kiln, when you heat the kiln, of course, the air expands as it's heated, and it can actually cause the pot to explode or to crack.
Pride is the air bubble in man's heart. It is pride that causes man to explode in anger, impatience, and other prideful manifestations during trials and difficult situations. Pride separates man from God when pride says that man can exist by his own talents and abilities. And so God uses relationships and the difficult moments in our lives to knock out the air that is pride in our hearts. When wedged, the heart can once more yield and be molded in the hands of the potter.
Centering is the first step in the actual making of the pot. And it's also one of the most important steps because this is where we actually bring the clay under control. So the principle of this is while the wheel is spinning, using water for lubrication, I use my hands to press against the centrifugal force of the clay spinning around. And this is what brings the clay under control. So this takes a considerable amount of force also. This also helps if I raise the clay up like this. It helps to bring it under control too, up and down. Okay, this is almost centered. The interesting thing about centering also is that the clay centers on the inside, not just the outside.
True centering in God should be from inside out. From inside man's heart to outward his actions. Expressions of worship that does not stem from the heart could only be described as ritualistic and even legalistic. But an intimate love relationship with God through his Son Jesus Christ that emanates from the heart enables man to worship in spirit and in truth, thus pleasing the living God. True conversion and spiritual rebirth begins with a humble, broken, and repentant heart. When man is not centered in God, the tendency is to rebel against the hand of God during difficult moments. But when man is truly centered, God is sovereign in man's life and is in control. Any burden will be easy. Any yoke will be light. To raise the clay to its designated height, the potter begins to open the centered clay. When man is centered in God, his heart will be open and will be willing to be raised by God to his maximum height and potential. All this with the end in view of accomplishing God's purpose for his life.
Okay, now I begin to lift.
The potter raises the clay in stages until the desired height is reached. The clay cannot take a drastic raising. Similarly, God raises the spirituality of man in stages, from a beginning awareness of a supreme being, to the saving faith in God's begotten Son, Jesus Christ, and ultimately, to a level of conviction that leads to joyful and powerful witnessing for God's kingdom.
So now I'm almost there. I'm trying to raise the clay up to the maximum height that I can raise it in order to get the full potential for the shape.
God persistently raises man so that man can reach his maximum potential in fulfillment of the purpose for which God has designed for him.
The shape of the pot, of course, would be, in the case of a functional pot, it's determined by function of the pot. If I'm making a flower vase or a pitcher or a plate or a bowl, it would have to be a shape suitable for that function. But there's also the element of aesthetics and style and form. And within those limitations of the function of the pot, I can also put some of my own personality into the pot according to how I make the shape. This can only happen when all the steps leading to this point have gone very well. And it often happens that there could be a big air bubble trapped in the clay. And then what would happen now, it would become a struggle. It wouldn't, it's a really a magical thing when the clay, when the wedging and the centering and the clay is perfect, and then when we begin to raise, it's so easy, the whole process. It's almost as if the pot forms itself. At other times when the clay is not so good, it's quite a struggle because the clay will begin to, it will begin to tell me the shape, but it will begin to resist my attempt to form it. It's really a pleasure when the potter and the clay are working perfectly together. It's a magical thing. So what I look for in a good pot is always this full expansion, where the pot sort of, where I'm able to give the full potential of the clay. I mean, the shape, in order to get a shape that utilizes the full potential of the clay. I think that's always the best.
God has a purpose for each and every one of us. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And God will shape us accordingly, to enable us to accomplish that purpose. He shapes us through our experiences, personality, physique, our skills, passions, and interests, and by the many relationships God brings into our lives. The role of man is to seek, trust, and obey God's plan. For it is a plan that God promises will prosper him and not harm him, that will give him hope and a future. But for the shaping to be most efficient, man has to be wedged of his pride and be centered in God from inside out. For until such time, man's pride and selfish ambitions will serve as obstacles that will prevent him from obeying God and from reaching his full potential to achieve God's purpose.
The interesting thing about these stages is I can't really force the clay to do, I can't force it to do anything I think of, but I can only coax the clay in the direction that I know it will go, it wants to go, that it's capable of going. If I try to make the clay do something really, really that it's incapable of doing, it will not succeed. It will resist. So in that sense, we're partners. I mean, that means for the potter, then the challenge is to understand the clay more and more, what it can do.
It is a partnership, the potter and the clay. As God leads, man must cooperate. For God will not force man to respond to his purpose. And yet God understands his creation and is patient. He will continue to court man to return to his love. He will do everything to enlighten the eyes of man's heart in order for man to see the hope, the riches, and the power of living in God's plan. And when man does respond by his own free will, amazing results will happen. And then the shaping will indeed become a magical thing.
And what I'm going to do is remove the excess clay from this portion here so that the pot will be perfectly even, the thickness.
This is the last refinement of the shape. And what I do now is I remove this area where the clay is a little thick, a little too thick. I use this cutting tool to remove it like this. So I shave strips of clay away in order to give it the final refinement of the shape and to make the thickness even. In a sense, this is like a correction of a bit of a correction of the throwing process.
God desires us to be perfect and beautiful, and so he uses events, trials, and relationships in our lives as tools to trim off the excesses that cloud our character. He prunes the undesirable habits, corrects our attitudes and behaviors. Ultimately, his goal is to make us Christ-like and more beautiful, befitting to be a citizen in heaven, and heir to eternal riches. The process may be painful, but rest assured, God provides grace to enable us to withstand the trimming. When the pots have been trimmed to its perfect shape, these are then left to dry. Porosity is at work at this stage to make the clay totally dry before it is put in the kiln for firing. The length of time for drying varies depending on the clay mixture, the humidity of the environment, and the size and thickness of the pot. Drying pots could be found in isolated shells and could end up covered in dust when finally dry. Oftentimes, man finds himself waiting. Sometimes, we yearn to get out of a situation and yet find ourselves seemingly unable to get out of the rut. In other times, life just seems so dry, a daily routine of repetitious tasks. It is oftentimes during these moments that God reveals a distinct lesson to be learned. It could be an area of sin in our lives that needs to be confessed, or an area of service that we have simply ignored and neglected. But it is often in these drying moments when God teaches us lessons of faith, trust, contentment, and perseverance, so that we can become mature and not lacking in anything. God is sovereign and determines the length of time for drying. He looks at several factors: the obedience in our hearts, the influences prevailing in our environment, and the underlying purpose for which He has designated for our lives. And yet, when we cooperate with God's hand, the drying times could be shortened. And when we are able to praise God amidst the drying times, joy and peace shall mark each moment, and the drying times shall be no more.
The purpose of glazing is not to hide the clay, but to enhance the clay. So sometimes it's also nice to leave some of the clay exposed. Glazes, of course, there have many, many colors and textures, and so the potter has to think about how the pot is going to be used, the form of the pot. Some certain colors and textures would go well with certain shapes and forms of pottery.
The pottery is made even more beautiful with glazing, marked by the creativity and inspiration of the potter. Glaze represents the spiritual gifts God endows to His servants. The kind of gift, and when it is given, is determined by God in accordance with His divine purpose. As man submits to the leading of the Holy Spirit, God endows these spiritual gifts and enjoins man in the building of God's kingdom on earth. The pot is first fired before glazing, for absent the stage of firing, spiritual gifts may end up unused, misused, or abused. Firing is essential to remove any remaining water from the clay and transform the clay into a glassy substance. The temperature in firing ranges from 600 degrees to as much as 1,600 degrees Celsius, depending on the design and purpose determined by the potter. The potter alone controls the length of time for which the pot is subjected to fire. Deep trials in man's life constitute firing. It is in these crisis moments, times in the desert, wilderness experiences, when man is humbled when he begins to acknowledge his inability to rescue himself, when he finally fully trusts and surrenders to the sovereign hand of God, instead of trusting in worldly things and in his own abilities. And God, in accordance with his purpose, shall determine the intensity of the fire, as well as the length of time the individual shall remain in the firing stage. Firing is important if man is to be transformed in his character to the likeness of Jesus. Firing is essential for the spiritual gifts given by God to be fully melded in man, utilized for God's highest glory.
A pot is always a reflection of the maker. But at the same time, the pot has a life of its own apart from me, which comes from the materials and the process, the fire, the clay. So when those two things are joined together, it can make a successful pot. But the thing I think that really I look for is that a successful pot has a spark of life. I think a good potter thinks of his pots almost like his children or something.
I think the thing that I dislike in my own pots the most is mediocrity. It's just when I see my pots that just don't look like they really have that spark of life, or there's not much character.
When the potter looks at the finished product, he remembers the transformation that occurred in the clay, from the mixing of the soil and water, to the wedging in order to remove the air bubbles, to the various stages of centering, racing, shaping, and trimming, to the drying stage prior to glazing and firing. And the clay will forever have these stages fossilized in its being. Above all, when the potter looks at the finished product, he shall remember his emotions and thoughts in each stage of his creation, leaving a part of his heart forever etched in the pot, imprinting his signature on it forever. Indeed, when God, our potter, looks upon our lives, he will have recalled everything he had allowed to happen in our lifetime, the joyful and painful moments, the growing and waiting moments. But all these things shall work for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And when we cooperate with God's plan and obey his divine hand, we shall maximize our potentials and fulfill God's purpose for our lives. We shall be our utmost best for his highest glory. Truly, we are the clay, you are the potter, we are all the work of your hand.